Hello everyone, and welcome to this RSA conference, a virtual session, The 5 Most Dangerous New Attack Techniques and How to Counter Them, continued from the keynote at RSA Conference 2019. I am your host, Brenna Dobbins of RSA Conference. During the session, all participants will be in listen-only mode. At the close of the presentation, the speakers will conduct a question and answer session. So throughout the presentation, if you do have a question, please use the chat feature, which is located in the lower left corner of your screen. As a reminder, the session is being recorded. Following the session, you will receive a follow-up email containing a link to the video replay. And the replay will also be posted to rsaconference.com. I would now like to turn it over to Alan to begin the session.
Hello everyone. This is Alan Paller, Director of Research at the SANS Institute. I have with me the three people who draw huge audiences at RSA every year because they are the people on the very front lines of the fight against most of the big attacks that are coming in cybersecurity. We have Ed Skoudis, who is the head of Counteract Challenges. He's also the person who's brought in by government and others after substantially every major attack to help them understand what happened. And he translates what he learns in those attacks into the kinds of courses that he teaches for SANS, and he summarizes it in the session at RSA and also in this session. He's also the person who's building the new team-based security training programs for the military and big companies. It's very cool stuff. And we also have Heather Mahalik, who is the person I know best as the country's top person in smart device forensics. She heads that area for ManTech. She does a lot of big cases, and she's going to come at the problem from the user's perspective, the person who has those devices. And third, we have Johannes Ullrich, who runs the Internet Storm Center, and he's the Dean of Research at SANS Technology Institute, which is the regionally accredited college that SANS runs. And he is the person who does the five-minute podcast that 12,000 people listen to every morning on what happened last night. So he's as up to date as anybody in the country on all of the new attacks. And having all three of them together in the same place gives you a chance to ask questions and get authoritative answers that just isn't possible anywhere else. And we ran into that in San Francisco. So the good people at RSA said, hey, you can do a second session, a follow-up session, where you can quickly summarize what you told them, but answer new questions. So that's the job. Your job as audience is to ask questions. It's your only major job. And with that, I want to introduce Ed Skoudis. Ed, you're first.
Thank you, Alan. I do appreciate that. Let me go ahead and try to move to the next slide. Let's see here. There we go. And I'd like to talk about two particular attacks that I'm noticing more and more in the cases that I work on as an expert witness, and also the techniques that we're emulating when we do our own penetration tests. The first is a set of attacks that have been occurring against DNS itself. Attackers have compromised so many credentials. I put on the slide here a bajillion. I realize it's not mathematically precise, but a lot of credentials, hundreds of millions, maybe even over a billion credentials have been compromised. Attackers have also compromised client systems and have pilfered from them all kinds of credentials and other sensitive information. Starting in the third quarter of last year and continuing through the end of last year and into the start of this year, attackers have used these stolen credentials and information that they've gotten to log in to enterprise customers who are using third-party DNS providers. Maybe the DNS provider is their ISP, or maybe it's some sort of other DNS provider. Attackers are taking the stolen credentials, using them to log in as administrators into the DNS provider stuff, and they're changing the DNS records so that the address records, instead of pointing to a web server of the organization, will actually point to the attacker's own web server. Or instead of an MX record pointing to the mail server for the given organization, it points to the mail server of the bad guys. And they've done this for dozens and dozens of organizations, including some law enforcement agencies in countries in Europe and the Middle East, as well as a variety of different companies. So attackers will redirect DNS so that they can point the mail record and the web server records and then they'll gather email. They're also applying for TLS certificates from some of the certificate authorities. And some of these CAs, like Komodo and others, will validate that you have control over a domain by sending you an email to an email address in that given domain. The attackers, by manipulating the MX records using DNS, are now able to receive that email and send an email response back. So now they have a TLS certificate, and that certificate's going to live for a good long time. There's been some great reporting on this. First, by Cisco Talos division, they called this attack DNS espionage, which I think is a pretty cool title. FireEye has done some really excellent write-ups on this, as has CrowdStrike, and always Brian Krebs stays on top of these things so well. If you want more details, please refer to any of those sources. But we're also talking about defenses here, and how can you defend against these DNS attacks? First off, you need two-factor authentication for all management of your infrastructure. Even if you've outsourced a piece of this, like a DNS or other activities, make sure you're using some sort of two-factor authentication when you go there. It might be SMS-based or token-based. Also, we need to vigorously deploy DNSSEC. And when you deploy DNSSEC, you've got to not only sign your records, you also have to make sure that the client software is validating the records. If you just do one or the other of these, you're not truly deploying DNSSEC. You don't have it. You also need to revoke any bad certs as soon as possible. If any certs were issued in the attacks that happened over that six-month span through fourth quarter and first quarter, fourth quarter last year, first quarter this year, make sure you revert those certs. And another thing, I really encourage everybody that's listening here working within an enterprise on the information security staff, you need to keep track of any changes that are happening to your DNS records for public access and any TLS certificates that are associated with your organization. And there's some free services that you can use to monitor this. There's one for DNS at Security Trails. You can register, and they give you 50 queries per month. You just say which domains you want to monitor, and you can query, and they will tell you if there were any changes. And that's free. Additionally, for monitoring for certificate changes, you can go to crt.sh or ntrust. They both provide free services that you can set up, query them on, say, a weekly basis or so, and see if there's any changes that have happened to your infrastructure. I'd like to move on to the second category of attacks that I'm seeing a lot. And it starts with this idea of domain fronting. Now, some people, when they hear domain fronting, think, this is really hard. It's really hard to kind of set this thing up. It's not. Actually, it's really quite easy to do. And some people think, oh, this is fixed. I remember it was about a year ago that that Google and Amazon said that they were going to block this. So this has gone away, right? It has not gone away. Google and Amazon have clamped down on it, which is very good. But there are other providers for which this attack is inherently doable. It's a really useful thing. So what is domain fronting, and why do attackers do it? Attackers do domain fronting so that they can have malware deeply embedded inside a victim organization that is communicating outbound for command and control or data exfiltration, but doing it in such a way that the target organization cannot tell this is happening and cannot tell where the data is going to. And I'd like to walk you through how this works. You see, on the bottom, we have a compromised system on an internal network. Let's say that's got some sort of malware, some sort of embedded piece of malicious code on it. And then we have a trusted website on a content delivery or content distribution network, a CDN. This is just one of the very large content distribution networks out there that hosts a whole bunch of different websites, trusted ones, and then maybe an attacker could actually even get an account on there and pay for it using stolen credit cards, maybe even stolen credit cards from customers or users inside the compromised network. The attacker also has a web server instance that is on that same content distribution network, again, paid for probably using some illicit stolen credit card. And then the attacker has their own origin server. What the attacker wants to do is to go from the left-hand side here, the compromised system on the internal network, all the way back to the origin server for command and control and data exfiltration without anybody knowing that the attacker is going ultimately all the way out to that origin server. Because if somebody on the compromised internal network can figure out where the attacker is, they might be able to get the attacker shut down. They also might be able to detect the fact that this nefarious activity is happening. So what happens here with domain fronting? In domain fronting, the compromised system, the piece of malware that's running on there, will do a DNS resolution for some trusted website. This is just a website that's hosted on the content delivery network that everybody trusts. It'll get an answer back, and then the malware will build a TLS connection from the compromised system on the internal network to the trusted website on the content distribution network. Now, that's just the front end. It's not the full website. It just builds a TLS connection there. Then, within the TLS connection, go to the next slide, the malware issues an HTTP 1.1 host header that includes a different name than the particular front end that the TLS connection has been connected to. And what some content distribution networks will do is they'll say, hey, no problem. I will forward that request to the appropriate instance. And it forwards that request to the attacker's web server on the content distribution network, which of course then forwards the request to the attacker's origin server. The big deal here is that somebody inside the compromised organization sees a TLS connection going to a trusted site on a content distribution network. What they don't see is that there is now an end-to-end command and control and data exfiltration channel going all the way out to an attacker. They have no idea what this attacker is. And this is a pretty nefarious attack. And it's just the start. You see, attackers have discovered that organizations are very much trusting cloud providers, whether they be content distribution networks, whether they be other cloud providers. Many organizations will have their firewall rather liberally open in communicating with their own cloud providers, and attackers want to take advantage of this. You see, organizations are just trusting what goes to and from the cloud, but other tenants of the cloud could be either compromised or themselves malicious. And if the cloud providers were to block, say, one set of malicious users, an attacker can actually go from cloud to cloud to cloud, kind of disappearing into the fog of the clouds, and we're seeing this kind of attack increasingly happen. Some attacker will get accounts at Google and Amazon and Azure and pivot from cloud to cloud to cloud, going after their ultimate target, which might be your enterprise. And then when you try to investigate this or try to get Amazon to shut something down here, Amazon can't block Google, right? And Azure can't block Amazon and so forth. So what can you do here? Well, first of all, to deal with domain fronting, remember there's that TLS session. You want to be able to peer inside that TLS session for connections going outside of your enterprise. The security team needs to be able to do this. So you could do enterprise TLS interception at your network borders. And there is a great document on doing this. It comes out of the Netherlands, and it's done by the National Cybersecurity Center. And it's called simply TLS interception. It is very well done. The author of this document communicated with me about a month ago and said that they're working on an update to it. But, I mean, the current version is excellent, and there's an update coming very soon. Another thing you got to be careful with is just blindly trusting what goes to and from your cloud provider. Assume that your cloud provider could have malicious other tenants on it, and be careful. Monitor that carefully. Consider those scenarios. There's also a great tool that is freely available. It comes from Black Hills Information Security, BHIS. The tool is called Rita. Rita analyzes traffic patterns and looks for really unusual ones that are consistent with command and control beaconing for various kinds of malware. It's got a bunch of patterns that it can look for in that traffic, and it can look for things like domain fronting. It's really a spectacular tool, again, available for free, and I'm thankful to Black Hills for releasing that. But let me turn it back over now to Alan Power so we can move on to the next segment.
Ed, that was great. We've got several questions that came in, so if you don't mind answering one before we move on to Heather, that'll be great. And for those of you who are asking questions, thank you. You make the session more valuable. I think two of them actually responded to your cloud provider question. I'll ask the more complicated ones. Are there any opportunities to identify when a cloud provider is compromised or a threat to your data? Or are we at the mercy of their compromised disclosure practices?
That's a great question. First off, you want to see what your cloud provider's disclosure practices are. That's something that should be maybe referenced in a contract with your cloud provider, or at a bare minimum, you should ask them about their disclosure. So that's one thing you got to make sure out of the gate. It's just part of that negotiation when you're setting up your cloud services. Secondly, you can monitor your own systems in their cloud. In other words, don't rely solely on your cloud provider to police their own cloud. You can implement intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems on their cloud, and do data analytics. In fact, at the RSA keynote presentation that this team did last year, I talked about some of the services available in the cloud for monitoring cloud-based access. So there's some really interesting stuff in the last year, the 2018 presentation on that very topic.
Cool. Thank you for doing that. We're going to move on. We have more questions for you. We'll come back to you. But we're going to move on to Heather Mahalik. And Heather, as I mentioned at the beginning, is the person who knows the most of all the people I know about what goes on smart devices that may have been compromised. So she'll be brought in, she'll send teams in when smartphones need, when forensics is needed on smartphones. So if you think forensics on smartphones, think Heather. Heather, you're on.
Thanks, Alan.
You're
all
welcome.
Right, let me take control of the slides here. As Ed was just saying when he was talking about cloud attacks, he's looking at a bigger spectrum of it. But consider this, what if you are the ultimate target? What if someone is out to actually target and individualize you and get access to your cloud where they can hop all over your private information? So what I want us to consider now is let's take a step back from all the big scale, large scale items and take a look at what if this happens to you. I've worked a lot of cases in the last year where I honestly thought people were insane and that they thought they were being followed, that they thought someone was hopping on their next devices. And honestly, it was unawareness to me on what was actually occurring. And then I realized they're getting access to cloud. And that is how when you buy your next smartphone, they're already on it because you are syncing from your old cloud data. So if you get an Android and you resync your Gmail account and your Google account, you could be pulling all that information down and they still have access to you. Same thing with iCloud. Everyone assumes they're safe on iPhones and you're not. So this is cloud in general. The issue with this is when people know where you are. They have access to all your devices, not just your phones and your tablets, but your computers that you're using that same cloud credential with. And the issue is you just can't shake it. Not only do they know where you are, they may know where you plan to go based on your calendar. They may know things based upon social media. So the more you put out there, the easier it is for someone to track you. And the biggest mistake all of us make is that it will not happen to me. I'm not that important. And I always make jokes about that. But it could happen to any one of us. There could be a good reason behind it. There could be something just completely obscure that someone finds a weakness in your type of protection that you're doing to keep people out. So how do these actually occur? It could be as simple as a weak or reused password. Heaven forbid you use something ridiculous like password or your pet's name, but people do this. Where I find the biggest discrepancy is lack of two-factor authentication. And Ed was just talking about this. Whether it's SMS, token-based, you need to have two-factor authentication involved so that you are at least aware when something is occurring. A good example, my husband is not a tech person. But he came downstairs one day and he's like, Heather, did you request something from our bank account? I got a code from our bank. And I was so impressed that he listens to me. It's brilliant when people actually listen. So if you got a code for something you didn't request, that should be a concern to you. Another thing that we all are guilty of, and this is myself included, and I joke about this all the time when I'm teaching people, what do you put out into the world? Can someone guess your birthday? It's pretty easy. If you look at someone's Facebook every single day for a year, even if they don't have specific information listed, you'll find out when their birthday is, when they get 300 birthday wishes, when they start tagging their children in pictures or their pets, or where Sarah Edwards wishes me luck on a presentation in Twitter saying, go get them, Hank. So now you know my birthday, my kids' names, my pet names, and my nickname. What if that can be used to reset a password? What if I accidentally click on something like a FairPlay attack on Apple and I enter my Google account username and password? All of these things can be used against us, and the issue is that they are being used. So just make sure that you're aware how you're logging into these things, how it can be used against you, and every time you want to be, I hate to say lazy human, but honestly that's what I compare it to. The lazier we get, the easier it is for others to attack us. So if we click on Google or we click on Facebook to log in on our behalf, what happens if Facebook or Google is already compromised and then we're just hopping across all these apps? So it's really just your awareness and considering what is out there. What you can do about it. Now this is on an individualized basis. And I've had people ask, and in San Francisco someone asked, what if it's against my entire network? Should everyone stop using Gmail? You should not stop using Gmail. You need to make sure your people are aware of the repercussions if too much is provided. If you look at your own myactivity.google.com, it is going to tell you what your cloud settings are. It is going to tell you if your location history is being shared, where you're sharing it with. You can pause this at different points in time. It will tell you, if you pause me, I can't help you with traffic and I can't help you with recommendations, but realistically you're safer. So you may want to consider doing a pause. Something else that I caution you on is log in frequently and just see what is public. What are you putting out there that's available? Google will walk you through a security checkup. If you look on the right side of the screen, you can see that it's telling me, hey, I have two devices with potential issues. If I want to click on those, it's going to tell me what the issues are. And then it surveys and it says, hey, these are security events. We don't expect you to be in Tokyo, Japan, but you logged in on a Linux system to your Google account and you logged in on an iPad. And fortunately for me, those were actual logins that I did. But it just tells you, hey, these apps are using two-step verification. These are third-party access methods that you have given through Google. So it's a good, clear chance for you to say, okay, how public am I? What am I giving Google access to? And how can I protect myself? If you follow their instructions, you will be safe. You just have to make sure you're logging in and doing a security check on yourself. And honestly, I would do it more frequently than I do. I am guilty, just like the rest of us, of several months past and like haven't looked in a while. And I log back in and just take a glimpse. It honestly could be 5 minutes out of your day that could protect your entire cloud data. The bottom line is this is a real attack. It is happening frequently. I see it all the time. The responsibility is not something that you can blame on someone else. It's yours. You cannot assume that you are safe, that you don't have things out there. Everybody has a bank account. Everybody has some kind of cloud-based, even if it's just Google Photos. What if your password is the same? What if you can hop on one and get to another or get enough intelligence from what you put out there to reset a passcode? I saw yesterday on Facebook that it was, what does your maiden name say about you? And I just start shaking my head because I'm like, now all these people are sharing their maiden names. You could reset some of my passwords probably with a maiden name or your mother's maiden name. In San Francisco, I use the example of what is your hacker handle? And you fill out this quiz and it says, what is your middle name? What street did you live on? What is your pet's name? And then it says, congratulations, Nicole Gizmo, you are now an awesome hacker. And then I share it with the world. You have to consider who is even putting these quizzes out there and then who is looking at them. So now you know my birthday, you know my pet's name, you know my middle name, my maiden name, a street I grew up on, and my first pet. You can do a lot with that. Sadly enough, with my first pet, you used to be able to reset my bank account. So make sure you're managing these things. Make sure you're managing what you're putting out there. Use strong passwords or manageable passwords. Consider your permissions and always, always use two-factor authentication so you're at least alerted if someone gets access to your account. Alan, I'm going to hand it back to you.
I like it. We got you really hit a nerve, I think. Let me ask you one quick question, then we'll go to Johannes. You did a little of this, but this person says, if I'm an average user, what are you suggesting I do to audit what the cloud providers have on me?
So if you have Google Cloud Data, which most of us do, log into myactivity.google.com, and it will walk you through a security checkup on yourself. Click on every single tab and just see where you've logged in, which devices you currently are allowing to access your Google information, and you can turn on and off location. If you are using iCloud or any of the other cloud services, you can do exactly the same thing. I find that Google personally walks you through more, does a little bit more hand-holding than the others, but just log in and pull your own data. start interacting with it and see what's accessible.
I bet that would be a wake-up call for every one of us. Thank you, Heather Mahalik. We now have our third wizard is Johannes Ullrich, who runs the Internet Storm Center, which is the early warning system on the Internet. A million people a month come visiting, and 10,000 a day listen to his, or 11,000 listen to his daily podcast of what the newest attacks are on the Internet. Johannes, you want to give us your favorite attack, new attack vectors?
Sure, and thanks for the introduction, Alan. And now I want to pick up a little bit with a protocol, at least, that Ed started out with, and that's DNS. DNS is always, as I say, my favorite protocol out there. And, why? You know, why do I like it so much? The reason I like DNS so much is that anything that happens in your network is sort of reflecting itself in DNS. So if you have access to DNS logs, you really know a lot about your network. But of course, that can also be used against you. Heather spoke about all the privacy issues. Now, where are these DNS logs going? Where are these DNS queries going? And just to take a quick look at sort of the DNS ecosystem here, I do have the next slide where I distinguish between these recursive and authoritative name servers. If you are trying to look up a host name, like here isc.sans.edu, that query typically goes to your recursive name server, which is a name server typically inside your network, often with your ISP, or maybe you may use one of those public name servers like Google's. And this name server now looks up the answers for you. Typically, these recursive name servers, they don't know that much. They need authoritative name servers to actually find the answers. So what does it mean for privacy? Well, let's just imagine that someone is able, some attacker here, is able to actually inspect the traffic between you and that recursive name server. This particular connection has an awful lot of information about you because, again, everything you do is reflecting itself in DNS and will be visible on that connection. The connections from the recursive name server to these authoritative name servers is actually less interesting to an attacker because you have all the queries from all the users of that recursive name server sort of mixed in with each other. So recently people thought about, hey, what can we do about it? In the past, a lot of security efforts in DNS did more focus on the integrity of the data and being able to authenticate the data came from the right location, like DNSSEC, for example, was all about it. But privacy really sort of wasn't considered much. Now, privacy, of course, in the last few years has become a big topic. You know, people are more and more concerned about it. There are a couple of solutions that are now coming up. Two in particular, one DNS over TLS, and then the other one I want to focus a little bit more on, and that's DNS over HTTPS. So first, quickly, DNS over TLS. We do what we do now with DNS. It's run over UDP. Now normal DNS is run over port 53, and we just wrap it in TLS and use port 853 for it to distinguish it from the normal port 53 traffic. HTTP, DNS over HTTPS takes a little bit of a different approach. With DNS over HTTPS, actually the browser no longer really uses any kind of traditional DNS infrastructure. Instead, it sends the DNS query directly over HTTPS to an endpoint, which then acts as the recursive name server. The problem with this is twofold from a defensive point of view. First of all, it's very difficult to block because it's HTTPS. With DNS over TLS, you can block port 853, and then people can't use it. But you cannot really easily block port 443. Now, okay, you say that's an advantage because now a bad guy can't block my DNS access, but the disadvantage of trying to defend by actually looking at your DNS log. The second part is also it's user controlled. It's a setting in the browser. So it's nothing that's sort of easily managed in a central fashion. And Firefox, for example, already started offering that protocol. And there are a couple of these DNS servers out there that take advantage of this protocol. So what can you do about it? Well, DNS over HTTPS is really sort of meant as a poor man's VPN. And that's really sort of what it does. Between HTTPS for all of your regular web access and DNS over HTTPS, it becomes very difficult for an adversary to really figure out what you did, and you get something similar to a VPN. On the other hand, think about the entire privacy equation here. You're now actually giving more data to the endpoints of that DNS point, like, you know, Cloudflare, Google, and such. So it really comes down to who do you trust more in the end. But it's not really meant for a managed enterprise network. In this case, it probably does more harm than good. Now, the second thing I want to talk about is sort of an expansion on what I talked about last year. Last year, I talked a lot about CPU flaws. And of course, you know, throughout the year, that turned out to be a big topic. What I want to do this year is look a little bit beyond the CPU. In a typical system, you have the CPU, and then you have a bunch of sort of peripheral devices that can also be used, that can also be attacked. Now, one example here are these baseboard management controllers. And I want to take a little bit of a different approach than what you usually have, but typically, when you do have a baseboard management controller, the threat is sort of the baseboard management controller being attacked. I want to show you how an attacker can actually use that BMC in to their advantage. So if an attacker has access to your system, has root to your system, they typically also have full access to the baseboard management controller. And if you ever work with, like, you know, one of those Dell DRAC cards and such, well, those systems come with various utilities that allow you to, for example, flash firmware, change passwords, and all of these things that you usually do with these baseboard management controllers. Now, classically, that's not sort of how you really use that BMC. The way you use it, well, you do have a management network, and use that management network to connect to systems via the baseboard management controller. Since that controller is connected to that network, the attacker can actually now attack the network. So the attack works kind of the other way around. Instead of using the baseboard management controller as an entry point due to a configuration mistake that you made with your management network or exposing the management interface to the open internet, which you never should do, well, now the attacker actually is using that baseboard management controller to attack your management network, which, of course, could potentially lead to sort of full access to other systems. So what we're really exploiting here is really a feature in the BMC. In addition, of course, with all these peripheral chips, we still have the vulnerabilities to worry about. There was just recently this vulnerability in the Marvel chipset that Dennis Salyan found, or Thunderclad, yet another variation of sort of vulnerabilities in Thunderbolt interfaces. So that all exists, but you know, think about it, this can also be used the other way around. So how do you defend against this? Well, first of all, you know, remove those management utilities, control the management network. It's secure, but it still needs all the monitoring that you apply to your normal networks. And then, of course, unique passwords for all systems. So if an attacker does get access to one, they don't get access to all systems. And that's what I got, so I'll hand it back to Alan, and let's see what great questions we got from everybody.
Yeah, thank you for the questions. I got one from left field, but I think it might be helpful to other people. Apparently, there are people promoting DNS services as safer. There's one guy sent in something about Quad 9 that supposedly protects you from accessing known malicious websites, and it improves your performance, and it preserves and protects your privacy, and you can set it up really quickly. Are these, I think it blocks up to 2 million threats a day. I think I've seen four or five offerings like that. Are they actually solving enough of the problem that users can kind of go in that direction and stop worrying about what you're talking about, or are they not really solving very many problems at all because they thought they blocked 2 million, but they let 98 million through? What's your thought on them, Johannes? Are those secure DNS services something you know about?
Yeah, those does DNS service, they really try to sort of address a little bit of a different problem. Open DNS would be another big one. I kind of like them for home users because they do block a lot of sort of relevant threats. And this approach is often also sort of called DNS firewalling, where essentially you just don't resolve some of these malicious host names, or you redirect them to some system that will then just detect that you may be infected, for example, by malware. They do make sense, these systems. On an enterprise level, I would probably rather sort of import the data that they're using. And there's this feature called reverse policy zones that really makes a lot of sense there. But for a home user, like I said, services like Quad9 and OpenDNS and so make a lot of sense. From a privacy point of view, they don't resolve the fundamental problem that you still have that choke point, that DNS service that knows an awful lot about you. Now, a lot of these services now do offer DNS over TLS, and in some cases also DNS over HTTPS. Again, for a home user, and particularly if you're traveling, for example, and you don't have a corporate VPN or something like this to connect to, then this is actually not a bad idea to use one of those DNS services over HTTPS or over TLS. To sort of avoid some of these Wi-Fi issues that they're running into. I've heard some people recommend that, you know, as a normal user, home user traveling, you almost no longer need a VPN because of DNS over TLS and all these sites now using HTTPS. Personally, I still feel much more confident using a real VPN in those cases. And then, you know, still using my internal recursive DNS server that will allow me all the intelligence about my network and allow me then to go in and actually filter and investigate what sites were being visited, what DNS lookups were being performed.
Cool. Let me switch back to Heather. Thank you, Johannes. Let me switch back to Heather. The question is, apart from our phones and the respective accounts, where else is location being tracked and how? Our location.
Is everywhere a scary answer? Because it's honestly a reality. It's tracked through your PC, through your Mac, through your Fitbit, your watches, any exercise app you have. I have a Peloton treadmill in my house, and it tracks my application and weather where I did my workouts and shares it with my friends. So honestly, anything that is electronic that you wear on your body or log into is tracking your location.
That's nice. Thanks. Ed, got one for you. If you going back to TLS interception, are there risks to organizations doing TLS interception? What are they? And if there are not any risks, why doesn't everybody do it?
Well, let me address the second part first. There is some complexity in doing it. You have to set up a TLS interception proxy, so you'll need somebody that manages and administers that. There are some risks associated with it, and they're based on this. There are a lot of checks that are done in modern browsers to try to make sure that that TLS certificate and the connection based on it are relatively legitimate. You have to make sure that your TLS interception proxy for your enterprise is doing all those same checks as your browser, or else you're not getting all the benefits of it. Also, if that interception proxy gets compromised, you lose. The bad guy owns you, right? I mean, and owns all the browsers in your enterprise that is using it. That said, on balance, I think it is a better idea for enterprises to do TLS interception at their network perimeters than not doing it at all. It gives you insight. Having raw, encrypted TLS connections that you can't peer inside, leaving your organization, you're asking for data exfiltration. You're asking for command and control that you can't see. So I think on the whole, it is better to do it, although it is more complex, and there are some risks to it. That document I referred to earlier by the Dutch government covers this quite well and how to make sure that you're doing it and doing it right. It's a great read for enterprises.
Cool. Hey, Johannes, got one for you. If virtual systems and Docker containers usually don't have access to hardware like baseboard management controllers, am I safe from these kinds of attacks if I use virtualization?
You're safer. You're not safe necessarily, you know, because you still have those escape attacks out of the container that could get you to the host and that you know makes it less likely that you're actually going to be attacked that way.
Cool. All right. Heather, I got two for you. One, is there a lot of vendors who don't support two-factor authentication or the ability to review your sharing settings? Others seem to have policies intended to prevent the use of strong passwords. With the balance of security and convenience being where it is there somewhere you would draw a line? I won't use this service if they don't do X.
My first concern is, why are they restricting it? What's in it for them to not allow you as a user to be protected? I find that a lot of places, it's an ignorance on why 2FA matters so much, that's the reason they're not implementing it, but then you should still be able to have a strong password or something you can change frequently. If you can't have two-factor authentication or a strong password, I would not put anything that I cared about in that location or application because you're clearly at risk.
And there's a follow-up on it. Are there opportunities to make it easier for providers to offer two-factor authentication? What's needed to make a huge shift in two-factor authentication becoming a standard rather than an exception?
It's honestly pretty easy, and there's a ton of free apps and guidance out there that will do it for you. I know that often Duo is used, and it's free, and it just provides a one-time code so that you can easily log in. And again, I feel like it's either bureaucracy that's in place preventing the implementation of this or just people being unaware of how important it really is for users to implement two-factor authentication because it's not a big hurdle.
So they could if they had the will, is your point.
Yes, and the ability, right, I guess, if someone's above you saying no.
Oh, right. Well, I think of that as will. Anyway, Ed, your section focused on DNS and TLS. Are those the main protocols we should be worrying about, or is there a third and a fourth that should be on our most worried about list?
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. I tell you, DNS and TLS are so critical and have such a long history of changes and tweaks and such that attackers really have focused on them. But there are other areas of concern, and you see these things kind of go in cycles and waves. You know, some people put a lot of attention on NTP, the Network Time Protocol, and find all of these interesting side channels and vulnerabilities in that. Or somebody will really focus down on SNMP, the Simple Network Management Protocol, and find some issues and vulnerabilities associated with that. So it kind of goes in fits and starts. But those are some that I would worry about. NTP, SNMP, I think somebody's going to find some things in those in the future. Border Gateway Protocol, BGP, is such a critical element of internet routing. That's another one that's a perennial concern. So I put those in some of those additional slots. Of course, then there's the underlying protocols themselves that just move things around, like IPv4, still around, gotten a lot of scrutiny over the years, IPv6, and also ICMP. So I think there's plentiful areas for attackers to continue to explore, and researchers too.
Cool. Johannes, got a question about data, about how real are these BMC attacks? The question is, how many data breaches in the last 5 years have been caused by a BMC attack? Is it having any effect, or is it all hypothetical?
Well, the attacks that we are currently seeing are just attacking the BMC directly as it's being exposed. Like I said, that's a bad decision to do this, but it certainly happens either due to vulnerabilities in, for example, the sort of web applications around this, or just no simple, plain default passwords. The newer BMC attacks I described, they're still fairly new. I haven't seen any actual breaches with that yet. There's sort of a variation of that, and that's what was referred as the bare metal attack. That's more speculative, that attack. That's why I didn't sort of mention it, in that if you, for example, rent a server in a data center, you don't necessarily know if they sort of reset some of the firmware on these servers.
Cool. Heather, one for you. That people are starting to hear about YubiKey and these kind of add-on physical two-factor things. Do they solve the problem at sites where you don't have two-factor authentication supported by the vendor itself, or do they not solve it unless the vendor works with it?
To be honest, I don't know in comparison on how it's actually going to work. I use it, honestly, on my own devices just for ease of use, so I am the same person and can access it different ways. I guess there's good and bad to it because someone else that is on my device could use it the same way. I don't know if Ed or Johannes have anything on this, but to be honest, that's something I would have to look into.
Cool. Ed and Johannes, just to put it in perspective, yeah. Jesper Johansson is now working for the main one of those, so somebody likes it. Where are you on YubiKey and the others?
Go ahead. Love to hear what you have.
Okay. Yeah, I think one big change that may be coming here with the entire two-factor authentication ecosystem is that there are now some standards evolving like WebAuthN and such that actually embed this into the browser that make it a lot easier to use things like the YubiKey hardware token, and actually Google came out with one to use it in your browser and even in mobile devices. Really excited to see where this is going, no matter it gets the sort of user and industry support that it needs to really succeed, but it is now showing up in pretty much all major browsers, so that part at least seems to be happening.
And Ed, any last word on that one, YubiKey?
Yeah, I think making better security easier for users to get access to is always a win, so I'm supportive. It depends on the support of the industry and getting products to integrate it, as Johannes said. But I think security can often be so hard for users. If we can make it easier, they'll use it more. Yes, it can still be compromised. It can still be subverted. But on the whole, it makes things better.
Cool. Back to Heather. I'm on a trip and connect my phone to the rental car Bluetooth for hands-free calling. Seems to me all my information is still in the car when I drop the car off at the end of the trip. Anything I should do?
You should never connect to the car. Honestly, you need one of those little lighter adapters. I still travel as one of them, and I am doing research right now on Android Auto and Apple CarPlay just to see exactly what's left behind. So stay tuned for that research in June that will be released because it's terrifying.
Thanks. I'm going to do one more for Ed, and then I'm going to ask each of you to give the listeners just one final word, one final takeaway. But Ed, if we could, if command and control isn't beaconing at regular or frequent intervals, what other aspects of the communication can be used to differentiate malicious from benign traffic?
Oh, there's a variety of things you can look at. One thing is just where it's going. You know, how often do your servers typically need to communicate with, certain parts of the world? Certain parts of the world you're probably not doing business in, and therefore that would be suspicious traffic. Another thing you could look at is the size of the packets themselves. If there's a uniform size, that would be an issue. You could also look at the duration of TCP connections. TCP connections tend to be fairly short-lived. If there's one that lives longer than your average or especially very long, you could look at that. Likewise, TLS connections riding on top of the TCP connection itself. So there's a variety of things you can look at: destination, packet length, connection times, beyond just the regular interval beaconing. The nice thing is there's tools out there like Rita and others that can help you look for that kind of anomalous activity.
Cool. I was going to go to the final thing, but we have one more question for Johannes. Are attackers more interested in cryptocurrency wallets than just user privacy stuff? Meaning, what are the attackers really looking for now?
Well, they're looking for whatever they can get, and it really depends on what type of attacker it is and what target they're after. Cryptocurrency wallets are still a big deal. They're still being stolen. They're less and less worth, their interest is somewhat fading here, I guess, but stealing them is still very easy, so yes, they're still a big target.
Yeah. All right. So let me just, we'll go in the opposite order. We'll start with Johannes, and then we'll go to Heather, and then we'll go to Ed for just a final, sort of what's the one biggest takeaway people might leave this call thinking about? Johannes, you're first.
Well, people always ask, how do you stay up to date? How do you figure out what's going on? And my big answer here is you really have to share with your peers, with companies in your industry, in your location, attend those security meetings locally, to really figure out what's going on and sort of put some of the events that you're seeing in your network in perspective. The one thing that probably made Internet Storm Center work is that people are actually willing to share what they're seeing. And I think that's probably our biggest weapon sort of when it comes to defending against, you know, all these evil kittens that are in your network.
I like that, evil kittens. First time I've heard that one. Heather, you're next. Heather Mahalik.
All right, so one thing I would like to put out there for everyone is it is our job to groom the next generation. Clearly, we all aren't getting any younger, and we need for this to keep going. And we don't want to groom button pushers. We want people who want to dig in and research and learn. And honestly, I am always asked to groom females, which is fine, and I'm happy to do it. And it's super important to get females in cyber. But every person who has gotten me to where I am today has been a male. So I think we need to take the gender out of it. And males can groom females, and females can groom males. We can mentor one another. I have always reported to a male, except for in one job I've had, and I have males report to me. So I think it's just gender equality across the board. Don't specify that you're only going to take a certain group under your wing because it's on all of us, and I honestly think that's the way it should be versus just based upon grooming the females because males need it too.
Thank you. Super. And Ed Skoudis, last word.
Sure. This is based on one of the questions that was asked there, and it got me thinking about this. People need to know these protocols better. They really do, to see what's happening, to understand these attacks. I am so thankful that we did a project a few years ago at a company I was working at, where we chose a protocol of the month. And everybody that worked in the company would study up on that protocol, like read the RFCs associated with it, or at least get a high-level view of how the protocol works. You know, we did January would be ARP, and then February would be IPv4. March, I think, we did TCP. April, we were very busy, so we did UDP, right, because it's a smaller spec, smaller protocol. I would encourage people with a technical bent to learn more about these protocols so you can see what's happening with these attacks. I'm not saying you have to read the RFCs for them, but are you familiar with the TLS handshake? Do you know the differences between the different TLS versions? If you don't, and you consider yourself a technical person, that's a sign to you. You should really read up on that. This is important. DNS, are you familiar how the DNS spec is set out and how queries are passed? You heard Johannes talk about recursive queries. Are you familiar with that? If so, that's great. They would suggest you probably learn more about it. So look up and read more about the TLS handshake. Read about DNS and some of the extensions that are happening to it. Johannes did a great job talking about DNS over TLS versus DNS over HTTPS. Are you well versed in that? If not, you should be. That's a big debate that's happening now. So I would encourage people to pick a protocol, just one, and start studying that one. And then maybe if you like it, you move on to another one.
Wonderful. Thank you, Ed Skoudis, Heather Mahalik, and Johannes Ullrich, and thank you to everyone who's on the line. We appreciate your time, and I'm going to hand it back to the capable hands of our hosts.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you to all of our speakers for a great presentation, and thanks to all of you, our listeners, for joining us for this RSA Conference virtual session. We hope you will join us in Singapore from July 16th to 18th for RSA Conference 2019 APJ. For more information and to register, please visit rsaconference.com. Thank you.